Good afternoon, Professor Bobbitt.
Good afternoon, everyone. Nice to be here.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Professor Bobbitt.
Good afternoon, everyone. Nice to be here.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Professor Bobbitt.
Good afternoon, everyone. Nice to be here.
The hand that rocks the cradle, the procreator, the mother of tomorrow, a woman shapes the destiny of civilization. A very good afternoon to all of you. On behalf of IIT Dharwad, I extend a very warm welcome to you all on this occasion of International Women's Day. I heartily welcome Professor Rama Govindrajan, Chief Guest of the Day, and Professor Vandana Nanal, IPA General Secretary, TIFR. Indian Institute of Technology Dharwad is an autonomous premier science and technology institute committed to provide a receptive and flexible learning environment with emphasis on hands-on engineering. Highly experienced and renowned professors add substantial value to the academics at IIT Dharwad. It is making its mark with robust research activities and all-round development of students. Significant strides have been taken towards construction of permanent campus. With this, I request Professor Narasimha to introduce the DAE C.V. Raman lecture series.
Good afternoon, Professor Rama Govindarajan, Professor Vandana Nanal, friends, students. We feel privileged and honored for having amongst us the eminent fluid dynamist Professor Rama Govindarajan and the Indian Physics Association General Secretary and notable nuclear physicist Professor Vandana Nanal. I should say both of them are women. We are very fortunate to have them on this International Women's Day. Today, virtual welcome to IIT Dharwad and hopefully very soon real welcome to the IIT campus. Now we are very happy to host the DAE C.V. Raman Lecture 2020-21 at the Institute. Now the DAE C.V. Raman Lecture Series is an yearly event where one of the distinguished physicists gives lectures primarily for students with the objective of exciting the young minds. This is organized by Indian Physics Association and in collaboration with the Board of Research in Nuclear Sciences of Department of Atomic Energy. We are grateful to IPA and BRNS to give us a chance to host this event this year. I hope the students get inspired by this talk by Professor Rama Govindarajan, and it will encourage, inspire them to pursue their career in scientific research. Over to you, Sushma.
Thank you, Professor Narasimha. I take this opportunity to introduce Professor Vandana Nanal. Professor Vandana Nanal was born and brought up in Dharwad. She did her PhD from TIFR, and now she is a professor at the Department of Nuclear and Atomic Physics, TIFR. She is one of the most renowned experimental nuclear physicists in the country. She is also the General Secretary of Indian Physics Association. It's an honor to have you here, ma'am. I request Professor Vandana Nanal to speak a few words.
Thank you very much. I am indeed very honored to be here today. As you mentioned, the Dharwad holds a very special place in my heart. And some of you may not know, but Professor Narasimha is my teacher too. He taught me in graduate course. So coming back to the IPA lectures, and I'm really grateful to IIT Dharwad for hosting this lecture. Professor Narasimha already introduced the lecture series. So let me just briefly talk about the Indian Physics Association. This was founded in 1970 to provide a forum for the physics community in the country to interact and also bring to the younger researchers to their knowledge the latest developments in the field. So it's kind of an outreach involving all the top academicians and the practicing physicists in the country. Because of the pandemic, as we all have gone to online, that the positive side of it is that many lectures and many events now have become available online. So I would request all the interested students to visit the IPA webpage, get the idea of the events of your interest, find them on the IPA YouTube channel. Many lectures, all these lectures are available offline. And do write to us if you have any questions or you want to host further events, please do become a member. And we do look forward to having an active IPA chapter at IIT Dharwad. I extend my greetings to all of you on this International Women's Day. And in fact, I hope next year you will have also a celebration for February 11th, which is an International Day of Women and Girls in Science. So in fact, all these three events put together, the 11th February, 28th February and 8th March, we can have an extended science month. We look forward to more interactions with IIT Dharwad. And now I also look forward to a very nice talk by Professor Rama Govindarajan. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I take this opportunity to introduce Professor Rama Govindarajan. Professor Rama Govindarajan is a senior professor at International Center for Theoretical Sciences, TIFR. She did her PhD at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, and a postdoctoral fellowship at Caltech. She was at National Aerospace Laboratories, Bangalore, and Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research before moving to TIFR. She is among the eminent fluid dynamics researchers of the country. Among many awards that she has received, Most notable is that she is the first woman recipient of Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in Engineering in 2007. She is a fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, the National Academy of Sciences, India, and the American Physical Society. It's an honor to have you here, ma'am. Before the lecture begins, I would like to inform the audience that you may post your questions on the link on the talk by following the link that is visible to you on the screen. This link is also available in the description of the YouTube streaming video. I request Professor Narasimha to invite the chief guest for the lecture.
I request Professor Rama Govindarajan to deliver this year's DAE C.V. Raman lecture. Professor Rama Govindarajan.
Thank you, Professor Sushma and Professor Narasimha. I will just share my screen. Do you see my screen?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay, so shall I start speaking now?
Yes, ma'am, please.
So in case there are questions, we don't need to wait till the end of the talk. Like somebody could please interrupt me and read them out. That will be nice.
Sure, ma'am, we'll do that.
We will do it.
Okay, so all of you have said, so first of all, I should really thank IIT Dharwad and Professor Nanal for this very nice opportunity to give this talk. I'm going to speak about one small aspect of my work, and I'll try to send to you the kind of excitement I feel about this work. So first, let us talk about Stokes' flow of a solid sphere. I chose this thing because a lot of, you know, young students will remember this from their, 12th standard or JEE preparation. I'm very sure that they've solved this problem. So for those who do not remember it, I'll just go through it briefly, and that will put us on the page of what are we trying to solve. So here we are. We have got a very, very tiny little spherical object. Let's think of it as a very small steel ball. So, for example, I keep it on the top.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah?
Sorry to interrupt. Could you please click on hide?
Hide.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, but how does that help?
On the screen.
On the screen, ma'am.
I clicked on hide and now my thing has gone away. My presentation has gone away.
Okay.
What do I do now? I have to stop sharing and start again.
Yes, ma'am. Please start the presentation again. There was some confusion here.
Oh. Yeah, do you see my presentation now?
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
So we were talking about, you know, a small sphere falling through the ocean. So suppose I just leave it on the top of an ocean at zero velocity and imagine that the ocean has constant density and so on, and this small steel ball is falling through. Now, when the ball is very, very small, we can, solve what is called the Stokes equation in order to get its dynamics. And now G.G. Stokes, can you see my cursor?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so G.G. Stokes in 1851 actually could solve the Stokes equation, his own equation and the steady Stokes equation, and get the drag on that this body would feel due to the fluid. So this body is falling down due to its own weight. That's m particle into G. It's being lifted up by a smaller force, which is mass of the fluid times G. This is the buoyancy force that you've studied about, what Archimedes found. So the fluid is reducing the gravity effectively. And then there is a drag force acting on this body. And the solution to that was given by Stokes in 1851. It reads as 6 pi times rho density of the fluid times viscosity of the fluid times radius of this little ball times the velocity of the fluid. I'm sorry that the kinematic viscosity nu and the symbol V for the velocity of the body are, you know, very close to each other, but this is nu and this is V. So then you know the three forces acting on this body exactly under the Stokes approximation. He solved this very complicated equation to give this drag. Now, when you look, so now I can write a force balance equation as we did in 12th standard. So like I've written mass of the particle times acceleration of the particle is equal to this force, and I'm writing V downwards. So it's this force minus that force minus that force. So I've written this force balance equation, just Newton's law. And now you see that all these quantities here are constant and only V is a variable. So I can immediately integrate this thing, and I know that the velocity at zero time is zero. So I get a form like this. So the only thing I want you to remember here is that velocity is reaching terminal velocity. At infinite time, it will be at terminal velocity. And it's reaching this terminal velocity, a steady velocity, extremely fast, exponentially fast. And there is a time scale associated with its reaching the terminal velocity, which is the body's density, sorry, rho p and rho b are the same. The body's density divided by fluid density times the radius square of this body divided by the kinematic viscosity of the fluid. Oops. Now, this is a time scale. Now, for, you know, most of the particles in air, like aerosol particles, little droplets, you can think of 10 micron as a reasonable size. And this tau for those particles is 2 milliseconds. And you can see it goes up quadratically in the radius. Now, the interesting thing is within 2 milliseconds or a few milliseconds, every body, every small particle which is falling through air or through water is going to reach terminal velocity. And the terminal velocity, if I neglect this thing, is just density, gravity times the time scale. So gravity is 10 in SI units and the time scale is like 0.002. So it reaches like a few centimeters per second. So these small bodies keep falling at a few centimeters per second. And in this entire exercise, we've made one big assumption. And the assumption is that the Reynolds number, and this is a number which I'm going to use repeatedly. So if you don't understand, please stop me and, you know, ask me to explain more. The Reynolds number is a non-dimensional number representing the inertia of any flow or any object. And here we have radius A times velocity V divided by the kinematic viscosity nu. The assumption here is that this quantity is way less than 1, as it indeed is for a 10 micron particle. So when this Reynolds number is very much less than 1, that's when you can use the Stokes equation. Even there are problems, but we won't go into that. Now, as this body is falling, you can imagine that you're moving with the body. Let's say you're in a Lagrangian frame of reference, moving with the body, you will see that the flow is going in this way. So these lines that you see are streamlines. So the flow separates, I mean, doesn't separate from the body, but it goes around the body and it forms streamlines such as this. And those streamlines can be exactly described by the solution of the steady Stokes equation once it has reached terminal velocity. So let's move on if this is okay. So let me give you some reasons for studying particulate flows. So here we are not studying just one small particle falling through still air, but we are studying a whole range of phenomena where there is droplets and flows, particles and flows. And throughout this talk, I'll use the words particle and droplet to mean the same thing, because we're not considering really liquid drops of large size except in one slide. So here is volcanic ash coming out of a volcano, and you know that, you know, any pollutant which comes out, we have to worry about how far it spreads. Sometimes the spread can be intercontinental, and we have to worry about this and model it. So similarly, marine snow is a very, very important problem. It represents large numbers of small plankton, small little creatures in the ocean, which actually capture carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, carbon from the atmosphere, and when they die and their fecal matter, all this sinks into the ocean. So like, we are the bad guys in this scene where we put lots of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, and these tiny little plankton are the good guys who then, you know, suck out the carbon and they try to clean up the air as much as possible for us. So if we want to understand them, we have to study this. Turbidity currents are when, you know, one example is like rivers which flow into the ocean, they carry a lot of mud with them, and you see this enormous flow which is, you know, turbulent. We'll come back to the word turbulent many times. Aerosols, like I'm an asthmatic, I need an inhaler to, you know, puff a whole bunch of medicine in the form of aerosol into my lungs. This is aerosol again, but, you know, on the world. So aerosols are very crucial for forming clouds, and clouds themselves are droplet flows. And then there is ocean spray, which is very important for forming aerosols. And of course, like, you know, nowadays, everybody is reading about cough droplets spreading through the atmosphere. So we've understood that every little drop is falling at a terminal velocity. It's reached a terminal velocity extremely quickly, and it's falling at a terminal velocity. So what is left to understand after 170 years after Stokes put his equation? What is like there? We know that there's a whole bunch of particles. We know the dynamics of each particle. And given the initial conditions, namely wind, particle location, size, this, that, by the previous, you know, 12th standard exercise, we can calculate like how far they're going to go before they fall, because we know how they are going to fall. So like, what is left to do? Like, why is there any science left? So I've written a whole bunch of, things which we need to consider, which even after 170 years, we don't understand. And in each of these things, there is like lots and lots and lots of work to do, lots and lots and lots of PhDs to be done. And, you know, like in the next generation, I'm really hoping that a lot of students will take up climate science problems, which are extremely important for the survival of our, life on Earth, and try to understand problems of this kind and, you know, try to solve some of these open problems. For these open problems, you need not be a geography student or a climate science student. You can be from any discipline like mechanical engineering, physics, chemistry, biology, and you can solve like bunches of problems of this kind. Even these problems can be solved interdisciplinarily by many, many people of different training. Okay, so continuing on what's left to understand after 170 years. So like I listed some of these in the previous page, and I've just given two photos here to make you understand the enormity of this thing. One is a snow avalanche on the left-hand side, and there's dust storms on the right-hand side. Now, like, you can see that these are many, many, many particles which are coming down in dry powder snow. It's basically many tiny snow particles which are falling down. And in dust storms, it's further complicated, because snow avalanches usually are not associated with the background flow, but dust storms are associated with winds carrying them. So there is a background flow which is already turbulent. In these, that may not be the case. But here is a photo I've drawn, just a few of these snow particles, and the avalanche particles I've drawn in purple, and the still particles which are lying on the base of this bed, I hope you can see, those I've represented by green. Okay, now is the problem that you're seeing this thing, the Google sharing my screen, is that the problem that you can't see this part of the page?
I think it's okay, ma'am. Like,
okay, because if I try to hide it, the whole thing goes for a six.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
No problem, ma'am.
It didn't happen when we were practicing. Okay.
Right.
Okay, so now, like, these particles are coming down the slopes. I've represented the slope here. Okay, and these particles are all coming down. And you know, I told you there are streamlines around each particle. So even if you think of each of these particles, they're all actually like tens of microns, hundreds of microns, small particles. But they generate a flow around themselves. And because they're dense in, you know, dense in the area, there's a lot of flow which is generated in the interstices. And you can see complicated flow streamlines which are like turbulent. They're actually turbulent. And what this turbulence can do is it can actually like go through these particles which were lying on the bed and pick them up. And that means erosion. So the whole bed is getting eroded. So in some of these snow avalanches, you'll see that what is starting with a very small few particles, like relatively small bunch of snow coming down, it will gather large amounts of snow as it comes down. So it will erode all these beds. It will erode the whole mountainside, and almost every piece of snow on the entire mountainside starts moving at a very fast rate. So like all of these, you know, they are high up, they have potential energy. So all that potential energy is getting converted to kinetic energy. And you have like enormous amounts of turbulence. So this is not just particles sedimenting. You can actually see it. It's very, very turbulent. It's like, you know, the whole thing is boiling. So like the flow around it becomes a very important feature of this thing. So we already see that it's way more complicated than just particles falling silently. And we'll come back to things like particle Reynolds number. Now, I keep on using the word turbulence. But what does turbulence even mean? Let's discuss that for a minute. Now, for simplicity, I've just said that any large-scale flow, like practically any flow you see on the Earth, on Earth scale, and also many, many other flows in real life. Like right now, you know, I switched on my ceiling fan to sit for this talk. So like suppose I had a magic way of seeing the turbulence in the room around me right now, then this is the kind of thing I would see. This is exactly the kind of thing I would see. So here, what is shown in color is, you know, you see these long rope-like objects. These are all locations where the fluid is, you know, rotating very fast, where this vorticity, which is the curl of the velocity vector, is very high. So like greens are one sign and reds are another sign. But the whole flow here is filled with, you know, tubes of many sizes, or sometimes even plates of different sizes. And it's like a bowl of many different pastas of different sizes and shapes, which are, you know, sitting in a bowl, except that these are not, you know, passive pastas who are sleeping in the bowl. These are pastas who are going to push each other, like ask each other to rotate by the Biot-Savart law. They're going to keep forces on each other, even far away. And they're going to get created. They're going to die. They're going to become stronger, become weaker, all kinds of things. They're going to get knotted, twisted. All kinds of things is going to is happening simultaneously. And the interesting thing is that in any situation, this is happening all around us. So any large scale flow is turbulent, whether it be, you know, the pollution that a bus gives out when it's running on the road, or whether it be anything. If you could see the vorticity, if you could see the curl of the velocity vector, you'll see something almost identical to this picture, except that the intensities will be much higher in real life. Like today's computers cannot do simulations which replicate real life, and we will come to that. So in this thing, all I've said is, suppose I took a teeny portion of this, you know, this is an oil spill and some burning thing on the ocean. If I took a teeny piece of this and I could see the vorticity, this is what I would see. So already you see that turbulence changes the answer. All this discussion about turbulence I gave you without any reference to particles. Particles in the flow are going to complicate things in many different ways, as we will see. Like this thing contains so much smoke particles that the whole thing is black. You can already see that the turbulence is made visible by the number of soot particles in this. So particles are going to change everything, and we will see that. Okay, so now, like, sometimes you have a background flow. Sometimes you have a background flow that's generated by the particles, and sometimes you have both. So like now we need, how are we going to solve these equations? How are we going to even go about understanding the first thing about them. So one easy way to start, it's not easy, but it's relatively sensible way to start, is by solving the Navier-Stokes equations for the flow and something else for the particles. We'll come to that. Yes, somebody had a question. Please ask it aloud.
No, ma'am, it was just a comment.
Okay. If it's not a question, we can move on. But please let people ask questions. Let's not wait till the end, because then it becomes easier for everybody to understand. So it's a request that you ask questions. Okay, so now you have, like, you know, this Navier-Stokes equation for the flow. It's nothing but Newton's second law written for each small blob of fluid moving around, where in each blob of fluid there are many molecules. So we're not talking at molecular scale, we're talking at macroscopic scale, but we are talking small blobs of fluid which are moving around, and P is the pressure and U is the flow velocity. RE is the Reynolds number, this time of the big scale fluid, not the particle. So this Reynolds number could be 10 to the power 800 million billion, more than a billion for geoflows, and on other planets it can be like orders of magnitude bigger, like on Jupiter or something like that. So like the simple story is, no modern computer with how many ever computers connected in parallel can begin to solve the Navier-Stokes directly for any of these flows. This is one take home message. And then there is del dot u equal to zero, which is just for incompressible fluids, and almost everything we consider is safely incompressible. I won't go into the reasons, but this is the other equation. So you have like these equations in three directions, three components of u and the pressure. So four equations in four unknowns, and grads are in space and there's time. So the independent variables are the three space components and time. So this is just Newton's laws for each blob of fluid. It's very, very complicated because of this nonlinear term sitting here, and every blob of fluid forces every other blob of fluid. So like you have to solve for all blobs of fluid simultaneously. On top of that, you have to apply correct boundary conditions. And inside such a flow, there are many particles. So as I've written this equation, I've said that the particles do not affect the main flow. But it could happen that the particles are so dense, like I told you in the snow avalanche, we'll have to add some forces here. This is the acceleration of the fluid itself. We have to add forces from the particles, which I have not added in this equation. They could be very complicated and many of them. And we have to add boundary conditions which need to be satisfied at every particle surface like this. So that could make life like impossible. I told you, just even without particles, this cannot be solved on today's computers for Reynolds numbers, which are this big. Then, like, when you think it's dense in particles, and each particle obeys something like the unsteady Stokes equation. Already, I made a terrible assumption that all particles are very, very tiny and that the Reynolds of the particle is basically zero. That's itself not a great assumption in many situations. But if I made that assumption, if I set this term to zero, it becomes the steady Stokes, which is what I showed you, the drag formula in the 12th standard thing that we discussed in the beginning. But most of the particles are accelerating and decelerating, so we have to consider the unsteady Stokes equation in the Reynolds number of the particle. So imagine if I have to solve this flow around every particle, even by the unsteady flow equation, the Stokes equation, and then connect those local velocities to the gross velocity here, then I'm in deep trouble. I have to do that because this thing is, each particle is way, 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 way smaller than, you know, the grid on which I'm solving the Navier-Stokes. That grid is very big and these particles are very small. So I'm in deep trouble. One important simplification came with the Maxey-Rayleigh equation, which was basically, you know, use the unsteady Stokes equation and make a huge simplification for tiny spherical particles. And on this page, I show you the Maxey-Rayleigh equation. It looks terribly complicated, but believe me, it's a huge simplification computationally. So like here, if I want to solve for each particle, I need not solve for the details of the flow around each particle. I just take that macroscopic velocity u, which I solve without worrying about the particle. I say that the particles are in dilute suspension. First of all, I can do that. I can say that I know the u already. I know the u, and this is an equation for getting the v, the velocity of the particle, where u is the velocity of the fluid. This is an equation for getting the v, knowing the u. And this is what it looks like. I will not go into all the terms and all that, except to point out that this term and this term, these two terms were already there in the 12th standard thing that we solved, except instead of v, I have written v minus u, because it's the relative velocity that matters now. So, and these are all the extra terms. Now, the one extra term I wanted to talk about is Bassett history. Now, Bassett history is a very complicated term. There's an important reason why I'm talking about it. It is to give you an example of saying that, you know, when you have droplets in fluid, it's massively complicated. We've satisfied ourselves by now that we need big computers and all of this. But there's also like lots of absolute theoretical work to be done. And this theoretical understanding is going to help us solve the big problem when we don't have that kind of computational power, A. And B, it's going to understand, it's going to help us understand what all is happening in the big problem. So like, and there's like a million such questions to be answered. So one of them is like, if I write the Maxey-Rayleigh equation, which is just for a very small particle whose Reynolds number is very small, for such a particle, I've written the unsteady Stokes equation in the form in which I can directly not bother about what the particle does to the flow. We're saying the particle is too small to disturb the flow, but what the particle does on its own in a flow. And that's the question we're asking. And this is like pretty exact for that. Under those assumptions, this is a pretty exact, you can think of it as a small teeny subset, derived from a small teeny subset of the Navier-Stokes equations. So like we will work with teeny subsets of the Navier-Stokes, try to solve those things and see how they go back into the big problem. So this is one game that we play, the Bassett history. So if I take the particle velocity v and the fluid velocity u, they're going to differ by this quantity w, because I'm no longer imposing the no slip boundary condition at the particle. I'm saying that the fluid is not disturbed by the particle. So the fluid grid is so big, so there's a characteristic velocity of the fluid and there's a different velocity of the particle. And if I want to solve for one particle, the acceleration of one particle, I have to solve this term. And what is this term? It's an, you know, historical time when the flow started to the present time t, an integral of the relative acceleration based on this dummy variable s divided by square root of t minus s multiplied by something plus something. But this is the term we're worried about. We have to integrate. There is a history of this particle on where all it went and how all it accelerated relative to the fluid. And because of, you know, the forces left behind in the fluid, it is going to face a force now that depends on its entire history. So imagine like in a cloud or in this volcanic ash or something, there's like 1,000 or more particles per cubic centimeter. And we're talking kilometers. So 1,000 particles per cubic centimeter, that's already 10 to the some big number per meter cube and some mind-boggling number. So we cannot solve this. Like for each particle, if we want to solve this history. So what do people in the trade do? They say, okay, I'm going to solve Maxey-Rayleigh equation, but I'll make a simplified version of Maxey-Rayleigh equation where I'll stop somewhere here. I will not solve for the Bassett history. And I'm saying we can't do this for each particle. It's impossible. So I will not do it. I neglect it even if it is unjustified. And like there's like an entire, you know, community of people who solve the Maxey-Rayleigh without the Bassett history. Not that they're ignorant, but because they can't do it. And they say, I will not do it. So bhul jao. So they leave this thing. So we asked, like, what can we do about it? And so, like, one day, my student Ganga and me, we were discussing, shall we try solving the, you know, Bassett history term for a few particles, because we're making this, we're neglecting this thing. And that's when my colleague Vishal Vasan walked into the room and he changed the game for us. So this is also an example of how people with different training, like Vishal Vasan is a stellar mathematician. So like how people with different training should keep talking to each other about their problems, and somebody or other can give, you know, a way, a new way of doing it. And this can be a nice leap forward for both of us. So two kinds of expertise can get connected in this. So this is one thing I wanted to tell the students, that always keep discussing your problem with everybody, like even with a humanities person, with any person, like keep describing it in simple terms and listen to them, like ask what they are solving. And even if you're not suddenly coming up with big ideas to solve together, you will become broader and broader. So the point I want
Professor, sorry to interrupt. There is a question from the audience member.
Sure.
I have posted in the chat box. So it is about the...
Can you read it out? I don't want to leave this window. It creates trouble when I leave the window.
Okay. So the Rand's equations for mean flow field require exposure for the Reynolds stress for turbulent flows. Particle laden turbulent flow. Do we need to change the Reynolds stress treatment? For example, using mixing length theory? That is the question.
Okay, that's a very good question. So let me, could you tell the name of the person who's asking it?
It's anonymous, ma'am.
Anonymous. Okay. So this is a nice question. The basic point of the person asking the question is the following. He or she is saying that, you know, this Navier-Stokes equation, I already told you that it can never be solved exactly for big Reynolds numbers. So they do some modeling where they take away this nonlinear term and, you know, make some approximations on it. And one way of doing it is called the Rand's equations. And so he or she is asking, I'm not going to get the velocity at every grid location very accurately from the Rand's equations. I'm only going to get a very big grid in which I'll have some velocity. So is that enough to solve for the particle trajectories? Answer, technically it's not. It's not. We have to, you know, solve the exact Navier-Stokes with the particles in them, and that's when we're going to get most of the physics. A lot of the physics will go missing if we just randomly take that U and put particles according to that. And we will see like what kind, some of the physics that we'll miss, such as particle clustering and things like that, will be totally missed, and we're going to talk about clustering. I hope that answers the question, or does Anonymous want to ask more? Okay, I'll continue. Please stop me again. I'm very, very happy to be stopped.
Ma'am, there is another follow-up probably from a different user.
Okay.
Different audience. Model the particle laden droplet in the turbulent flow. It's already addressed in this one, so you could probably address that. Also.
Could you read that again?
How to model the particle laden droplet in turbulent flows?
Yeah, so that's what we're talking about here. So what we are saying is, we are going to solve for the flow here in Navier-Stokes. And the simplest thing we can do is solve Maxey-Rayleigh for the particles. So we're going to take the big flow and solve Navier-Stokes, and we'll get the U from there. And then we'll solve Maxey-Rayleigh for the particles. This may not be enough in when the particles are dense in the fluid, or there's other reasons, in which case I'll take back that V that I got and put back the forcing into the Navier-Stokes. So I'll add a particle forcing term in the Navier-Stokes. So these two equations will talk to each other. I hope that's clear.
Thank you, Professor Ramarangarajan. I think you can go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so then, now this Bassett history term, this term alone, just memorize it for 1 second. And then we go here. This term, I've represented it by H, which is for half derivative, is actually a fractional derivative of W in time, half derivative of W in time. So where dW by dt is d half by dt half of d half W by dt half. So this is a standard expression for the half derivative. So if you do, you know, if you do derivatives for complex numbers in in your first year maths or somewhere you would have studied, maybe in higher years of maths, you would have studied like how to write the nth derivative in terms of, you know, factorial quantities and stuff like that. So this is, instead of the factorials, we'll be using gamma function because we're talking about fractional derivatives. So there is no surprise for why this comes. It comes due to, you know, the same reason that I'm going to talk about. But this whole term is a fractional derivative, half derivative in time. So what is Vishal's idea in this? He said dw by dt in the heat equation. So let me write an imaginary heat equation where I introduce an imaginary variable x. And I say, like, I write this, you know, I'm now going to take this ordinary differential equation and I'm going to make it into a partial differential equation. I'll falsely say that, and I have a right to do this. I can say that all my dw by dt's are equal to d square w by dx square in some x. I have every right to do this. Once I do it, this h, which is the half derivative in time, becomes a full derivative in x. And the reason that this happens is because of viscous diffusion, which brought in the Bassett history term in the first place. But so Vishal's idea was to write it in the form of a heat equation. And then he used like pretty fancy maths by the unified transform method, which we learned from him. And we could solve this full Maxey-Rayleigh equation, which has not been solved analytically before. We could solve it for analytically for a whole variety of situations. And this was a comment on our paper by Haller in Focus on Fluids 2019. So Haller said this thing that, you know, people are neglecting this term even if it's unjustified. And now is a good way of, we now have a good way of including that term. So what is that good way? Once you write it in the form of a heat equation and we solve the heat equation, instead of solving the entire history of this particle, instead of storing the entire history of this particle, and very quickly any computer is going to run out of storage if you're going to do that, you can actually store only some few Fourier modes for each particle. So 10 Fourier modes we found was more than enough. So even numerically, we can solve the full Maxey-Rayleigh rather than a false Maxey-Rayleigh or partial Maxey-Rayleigh. So this was the idea. So then, like Bassett in 1880 something said that each instant in the particle's past affects the force it feels. And we said, okay, but we need not remember each instant individually and start each time at time equal to zero. We don't have to do this. We can instead store some Fourier modes. So this was the idea. And we, as I told you, obtained several analytical solutions of the Maxey-Rayleigh equations for the first time, thanks to Ganga Prasad, my recent PhD student, who is now a postdoc in Harvard, and to Divya Jagannathan. She's now started taking off from where Ganga left off, and her PhD is on this topic, among other things, which is very nice. We can solve many more problems on this with Divya. Now, the point is, remember in the 12th standard thing I told you, like, let's go back for a microsecond. This thing I told you that the velocity is given by this equation where it's V terminal times 1 minus e to the minus something. So exponentially fast it reaches V terminal because I know the drag, I know this, I know that. But wait a minute. This drag was got by the solution of the steady Stokes equation, which actually I had no business doing. So I had to actually do the Maxey-Rayleigh, which would give me the unsteady Stokes and the unsteady version of all the drag forces that this particle is feeling. And now, like, we're able to actually solve that analytically, and we're able to get the, oh, it's not exponentially fast or anything. The terminal velocity is reached at t to the half, with it's going like a square root in time towards the same terminal velocity. The terminal velocity is still correct because it's steady Stokes, but the rate at which it's approaching terminal velocity is way, way slower than we thought. So each particle, just assuming it's falling at terminal velocity, can be quite wrong. So even under the settling by gravity problem, we found a, you know, difference. And this is only at long time. At short time, we've got a much more complicated expression. So this is one example which by which we can show that this 170-year-old problem is not at all solved. So on this Bassett history thing, does anybody have a question? Even if the question is to say, repeat everything you said and it didn't make sense, I'm happy to repeat. If the time is up, I need not complete my talk. I can stop my talk halfway and carry on. So please ask a question if you have any.
But Professor Govindarajan,
yes.
One question I think in the chat box, someone said, see, if you use Navier-Stokes for the fluid.
Yes.
If you have some particles of very small size, density the same as that of the fluid, and you use the Maxey-Rayleigh equation for them, do you get solution is the question in the chat box.
Okay. So like typically when the density is the same as that of the fluid, they will not settle under gravity. And you can get away with, like just thinking of them as passive scalars. So if they're very, 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 very small particles whose density is the same as that of the fluid, you can get away with saying they are tracer particles. So like I can just say V is equal to U. I can say V is equal to U. And then I need not solve the Maxey-Rayleigh. Already, if I know you, I know everything about the particles. It's only when they are heavier than the particle or lighter than the particle that these things become significant. And for example, this gravity term will become significant. And, you know, their inertial behavior will become significant. They will show a, you know, reluctance to follow the fluid streamlines. And this time constant is a measure of that reluctance. They will start centrifuging outer vertical regions. They'll do lots of extra physics only when their density is different from that of the fluid.
But
I hope that answers that question.
But is it very clear? See, if you do not consider heat, it is probably right. But otherwise, maybe one can think about it later. Yeah, and the person who asked might bring it back, I think.
Okay, towards the end, they can bring it back. Okay, so now we talked about turbulence. We talked about the unsteadiness of each particle by which we need to solve unsteady Stokes equation. In this slide, I'll just show that shapes are important. We're not going to discuss maths. But here we simulated a bubble which is rising with my ex-students Tripathi and Kirti Sahu, Manoj Tripathi and Kirti Sahu, who are now faculty in ICER Bhopal and IIT Hyderabad and doing very well. So like this is just a bubble which is rising, and imagine a big raindrop which is falling, like a 1 millimeter or 100 micron raindrop which is falling. There'll be flows inside it. I cannot treat it as a solid. It may not even have a spherical shape. It's going to have some, you know, skirt-like shape or something like that. These are actually drops, not bubbles, which look like some shape like this. So the whole flow around it can become important. None of this Maxey-Rayleigh is going to work anymore. And ice crystals in cirrus clouds, for example, they have all kinds of complicated shapes, and their sedimentation is going to be very different from this spherical Maxey-Rayleigh thing. So shape can become very important. Only the tiniest drops, because of surface tension, they remain spherical. As they become bigger, gravity says don't remain spherical. And the flow says do some other thing. So it occupies very complicated shapes like this red shape that you see. And then like there is also size. So like here I've drawn like, you know, suppose we want to see how raindrops grow. An important question is how frequently do they collide? And every time they collide, you say they've coalesced and become a bigger raindrop. So like lots and lots and lots and lots of collisions need to happen to create one raindrop. So if you start with 10 micron droplets, 1 million of them joining together is going to make one millimeter raindrop. So 1 million of them have to coalesce. So this is a very, very important thing for raindrop formation, collisions and coalescence. So now like if I see like here, there's a big drop. It's falling faster than the small drop. The small drop is sitting here. So now you think, oh, great, the big drop is going to fall. It will collect the small drop as it comes down. So like I can count one collision, but wrong. This small drop is going to follow the streamline. And it's going to go that way instead of, although it's directly below the big drop, it's not going to collide with the big drop. So like all these things start mattering. And even as it comes very close, there's like hydrodynamics. There's a thin layer of air between these two drops, which is going to need to be expelled if they have to coalesce. So lot of complicated physics and lots of new questions are there in this itself. And as they both come very close to coalesce, like molecular effects become important. So you cannot live with, you know, Navier-Stokes, shallow water theory, all those break down just before coalescence. So there's many, many questions of droplet, you know, collisions and coalescence where, you know, simple-minded Maxie Riley is not going to give you the answer. And there are facts and corrections, which I won't explain. There's so many things due to shape. Then we have to talk about particle Reynolds number, which till now we've been pretending is very close to zero. Now here is just flow past a rigid sphere where the sphere is held fixed, but the flow around it is flow is going past it. Even in that case, you know, like big raindrops of 1 millimeter and all can have Reynolds numbers of this kind. And so you see that as the Reynolds number increases, just the flow behind a fixed sphere becomes more and more and more complicated. Even if there was no flow outside, but just a constant, you know, the ball is falling with a constant velocity u, this is the kind of complicated flow behind each droplet or particle. There are vortices of the, you know, hairpin type, which are wound in this way, and at higher Reynolds, it's like just turbulence due to one drop or one particle. So this is the kind of complication that comes from particle Reynolds number. So then, so in this thing, we've talked about turbulence, we've talked about a variety of things. If I have time, I seem to be running out of time. So shall I skip this thing about caustics? Can somebody tell me like how much time I should wind up in? I'll decide how much of this to speak on based on that.
Can you please continue? Like we are willing to learn more.
Is that okay? Like,
definitely, ma'am.
Okay. So, anybody has any questions on this Reynolds particle thing?
As of now, none, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. So, you follow that if I have a bigger and bigger particle, already I'm in deep trouble with Maxie Riley. I should not be using anything simple. We already saw that Maxie Riley is hard enough, and this makes it even harder. Now, what happens when particles and turbulence talk to each other? So I would like to return to turbulence and just give you a feeling for how hard the problem is. So this is work done by Jason Picardo, who was postdoc with us and now is faculty in IIT Bombay, and S. Ravichandran, who is now postdoc in Nordita, and he actually did a huge amount of work on this, and his thesis is based on this kind of work. So like, so I'll first run the movie created by Jason to give you an idea of what's happening. So you know that, you know, anytime there are heavy particles, they will get centrifuged out of rotational region. So if I rotate something very fast, I see centrifuging. So you see that every time there's a vorticity or a vortex, the particles are leaving that region and they're you know, agglomerating and preferentially concentrating in other regions. So the number of collisions and all happen can be much greater if you understand that turbulence is actually segregating particles. So you see that this is what is happening in any turbulence. This part is well known, like Jason's results are not this, he's got lots of other results, but I just showed it to make you understand. So we said, what can we do analytically to understand this problem? So we said, let's take one vortex, which is this little black circle, is just one vortex, and it's called a Lambosian vortex. It's an exact solution of the Navier-Stokes. So we take this one vortex, we put particles around it. And each of these red and green dots is a particle which is heavier than the vortex, much, 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 much heavier. So you think of water droplets in air or dust particles in air. It's like that. So like we put lots of particles. I have colored, and this particular one is, the particular reference here is this Physical Review Fluids 2017. So what we did is we colored these particles green and red for a reason. I'll tell you later what the reason is. But what we do is we say that all the particles starting near the vortex, we color them green. Within a particular special radius of the vortex, we color them green. All the particles outside the special radius, we color them red. And each time, like two particles collide, if a red collides with a red, we coalesce them, we make a bigger particle, but that particle still stays red. If green collides with green, we color it navy blue. If green collides with red, we color it navy blue. If navy blue collides with anybody, it stays navy blue. So navy blue droplets are those droplets who have some green blood in them, who have some contribution from a particle near a vortex. And so, like, when, so the thing is, the interesting thing is that why is a thing like maxirizing important? Like, why can't we just solve a field equation for particles? Like, just write average equations for particles. Why do we have to solve them individually? The reason is that when you solve for an average velocity field of a particle, you're going to miss a lot of physics. For every big flow grid, you'll have a typical particle velocity. That will not be good enough because particles can go at different velocities. They can dash against each other with different velocities. Namely, particle dynamics does not represent a field. Field means if I'm given x, y, z and time, there should be one typical velocity. But particle dynamics is not a field. So imagine like a road, like there's a street outside, you can't see it here, which is very noisy. And you know, every second there's like bunches of vehicles passing through. And if I go stand there and say, I want to get the velocity of the road, not the velocity of each particle. That would be like asking for a field equation. I'm giving you x and time, give me a velocity. That would be like a field equation for the thing, which I cannot do. Like if I had a field equation and all my vehicles went through some typical velocity, I'll never have accidents or collisions. And their accidents are bad, but in cloud flows, accidents are good, like collisions are good. Without them, we cannot get rain. So then, like, what we've shown here is that this radius is very special, and we've shown this analytically, semi-analytically, we've solved ordinary differential equations. This radius is extremely special. Whoever starts inside has a great chance of becoming a raindrop. And now I'll play the movie. If there's a red drop, yes?
There is one question in the chat box.
Please ask.
That if you were to look at those particles in the turbulence, they concentrate in the shear layer. So that is the question that, you know, you mentioned about these particles. Yes, the question is that whether they can concentrate on the shear layer or whether whatever you are talking, diffusion.
Okay, what is shear layer? Which, like, are they talking about the atmospheric boundary layer? Which kind of shear layer are they talking
about? My understanding is they are talking of a boundary, but boundary. I don't know what they mean. Probably that person can.
Okay, see, when you have a boundary, like a lot starts changing. Yes, like you can have more dust particles in the boundary, I mean, very close to the earth. And that's not because of the shear. That's because, partly it's because of the shear turbulence that the mud is getting lifted up from the ground and you're getting many particles. Similarly, in an ocean, like you can have spray formed very close to the ocean surface, which contributes to the number of particles. So you'll find a bigger particle density in such layers, but there can be multiple reasons for it. The reason that we are seeing here is plain centrifuging. Every time you see a vortex, a heavy particle will get centrifuged out. And we saw that in a overall Navier-Stokes simulation, but I'm just taking one of these vortices and I'm trying to solve it analytically. I've not solved it for a complete shear layer, but I've just solved it analytically for a tube-like vortex, not a plate-like vortex. So like, since most of the vorticity is in tube-like structures, we are focused on the tube-like thing and we are asking what happens. And in this thing, we are showing that starting near a vortex gives you a much bigger chance of becoming a raindrop than anybody else. So let me remind you, if you see a red drop, that guy didn't start near a vortex. But if you see a navy blue drop, that guy had some green blood or some bit of green particles, green droplets. So this is how like a single vortex dynamics proceeds in time. You see centrifuging, we've actually solved simple ordinary differential equations to get this. And you see that almost everybody who's growing big, of course, the people who grow big are going to run faster. They're going to get centrifuged faster. And they're almost all of them is blue, which means that if you start near the vortex, you have a better chance of being the seed of a big raindrop. So this is a kind of work you can actually do with pen and paper quite a distance and prove like how raindrop formation is aided by being near a vortex. So like here, we've gone back to the question of turbulence and how turbulence creates bigger drops is one question we're answering here. So if I just said, oh, all of them are sedimenting, I would miss all of this. I would miss the fact that turbulence is doing things to droplets, droplets are doing things to turbulence. And this is just one example of the way they interact. Shall I move on? Okay. So here, I'm not able to give you, like this will involve a separate lecture, but just believe me that as the Reynolds number of the flow becomes higher and higher and higher, you get finer and finer and finer structures. So that is what this somebody else's simulation is saying. As the Reynolds number becomes higher and higher and higher, you see finer and finer and finer structures. Another way of looking at this is, if I take a box of this size, which is at very high Reynolds number, and I divide it into many grids like this. You know that I'm Navier-Stokes is a bunch of partial differential equations. I can't solve it unless I make a grid. I mean, the best way to do it is to make a grid and, you know, solve it for like difference equations or Fourier transform or do something and solve it on a finite grid. And each grid is delta x in size. If I do that and I divide it into, let's say, here they've divided it into 256 cube points, 256 on each side. Then I see some mishmash. I don't see the real structures. I make it finer, 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 finer. And now I'm able to see like structures. And remember, each of these teeny vortices is way, way, way bigger than particles. Particles are very, 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 very small. Here this this lambda is actually the Kolmogorov scale. The Kolmogorov scale is like the smallest, you can think of it as the small scale vortices that are going to happen. And this scale for a given length keeps going up with the Reynolds number, keeps going down with the Reynolds number going up. So the bigger and bigger and bigger the Reynolds is, the finer and finer and finer your scales are. So if I'm trying to solve it, I should make a grid where the L is divided into enough tiny boxes of size delta x. The tiny delta x should be less than or equal to lambda. Otherwise, I will not get all the physics. And even to solve Maxey Riley, I will need to get every vortex correctly. And more fine it goes, the more and more strong and intense these vortices become. So if I do this, I'll get weak vortices. If I do this, then only I see that my vortices, tiny and strong vortices come out. So I have to solve it like this. So if I want to do that, then what happens? So let's take a tiny part of a cloud, for example. In this, the L by delta X is about 10 to the power 6. So I need a million grid points on each side. That means 10 to the power 18 grid points to solve the Navier-Stokes exactly, let alone particles. Particles are way smaller. Navier-Stokes exactly, I need 10 to the power 18 grid points. The biggest simulation so far in the entire world is 16384 the whole cube. So 16384 is so much smaller than 1 million. So we are not able to solve for, you know, a cloud. There's no way that any computer can solve the Navier-Stokes for a cloud, which is why things like RANS and all are used, which actually are not good enough to get this kind of physics. RANS is good to get some average properties, but it's so not good enough to get this kind of physics. To get this kind of physics, you have to get the small scale correct. Otherwise, you're lost. So when you Fourier transform the Navier-Stokes, you'll see that every scale forces every other scale. So like if I have a teeny scale of the order of 0.1 millimeter, it will be forcing a scale which is, you know, meter in size. That will be forcing a scale which is kilometer in size. They all put forces on each other because it's a nonlinear problem. So like in order to get that correct, we cannot do anything except solve the whole thing. What people do is they do this thing called large eddy simulations. And now I'm only talking about Navier-Stokes. I have to remind you that there are 10 to the power of 9 tiny drops per meter cube. In this little tiny box, there's 1 billion drops, whose Maxi Reilly I should do. So this is messy at any Reynolds, even if those droplets are very, very tiny. And we know that these droplets are not very tiny. Not always very tiny. And then, like, this part I didn't talk about at all. We are pretending as if the flow is just moving the droplets. Droplets are slaves who are just obeying the flow. Wait a minute. Even if they're very, very dilute, the droplets can grow and shrink because you can have supersaturation in a cloud, for example. They can collide and grow. There's many things happening. If their phase change happening, like there's condensation happening on the droplets in a supersaturated environment, then latent heat is given out. That creates buoyancy in the flow. And then that creates potential energy in the main flow, and that gets converted to kinetic energy. So these tiny droplets are actually feeding chemical energy, which is getting converted to kinetic energy in the flow. So many complicated things are happening at the same time. And each of these can be broken up into teeny tiny questions. So some of these droplets have flow, which is like this behind them. And they are like, you know, smaller than a grid size here. So, like, I had to resolve all of this if I want to get it right. So there are tricks to do those things, which I won't go into. So, like, here is more arguments for how many grid points you need on droplet scale, flow scale, and so on. One last thing I want to show here is how they interact with each other. So, like, remember we started out with these teeny tiny spheres falling in a viscous fluid or falling in air or something at low Reynolds number. So then we're talking as if they don't affect each other. And if there is two of them, they go in a particular way. But let me show you what happens to three fluid particles falling in what we think of as steady Stokes flow. So just see these three spherical particles. They're interacting. So the middle guy is going faster. They're clubbing around. They're clustering. So just three particles are doing this. Now imagine if they're not circular. I told you ice crystals and all are not circular. Look at what they're doing. They're entraining into each other. They're, you know, wobbling around each other, rotating around each other. So imagine that the turbulence that dust particles which are not circular can create around them even when they're very, very small. This is the work of Rahul Chajwa, who's just finished his PhD. And we had a farewell for him a few days ago, and he's gone off to Stanford for a postdoc. So here's another movie by Rahul Chajwa on particles that he's released in a row. So you see the beautiful kind of, you see the instability that's created there. What am I doing? Yeah. You see a beautiful instability then goes nonlinear. So even a row of cleanly placed disks with known separations is doing this kind of thing. And this is because the system forms a non-normal matrix, and there's a lot of simple maths we can do, which I won't go into. Those who are interested can read this paper. And this I won't talk about. And before I stop the talk, I would like to thank my past PhD students from whom I've learned a lot. I've written their present places. Most of them are faculty now. I couldn't talk about all their work, obviously. And another list of more recent past students and who worked in many different problems such as oceans and many other things. And this is my present group. And we talked about all these things. We didn't have much time to talk about coalescence and phase change in any detail. So my summary is this. In each aspect of this and many more aspects, there are many, many PhDs to be done. This is just one aspect of climate science, one teeny aspect of climate science where, you know, carbon sequestration, some of these questions we can ask with these tools. And so, like, this is something which lots of students need to get into. We've talked about some theoretical aspects, but there are many, many practical questions that need answering. Like, how much carbon can I keep putting into the atmosphere and hope that living things will take care of that? Such questions are there. So, like, this is to, you know, entrain young students into this kind of questioning. Thanks for your attention and happy to take more questions.
Thank you so much, Professor Rama Govindarajan, for a enlightening and insightful talk. where for climate science, starting with our Stokes' law, which the students are very familiar with, giving about the snow avalanche, then explaining the Maxey-Rayleigh equation, and going to full-blown turbulence, indicating very many of the niceties and the complexities. I think now, yes, here Professor Dheeraj Patil comes with one.
Hello, Dheeraj.
Hello, Professor Rama. I have a question regarding the simulation that you showed. You had used three spherical particles. Nowadays, also there are few simulation attempts. Where
this is not a simulation. This is an experiment.
Experiment. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I thought you had seen that. Like in this thing, you see his hand coming and putting this. Shall I play this for you?
Okay, okay.
Let me play it for you. See, he's coming and pushing that thing. Do you see on top?
Yes, yes.
This is an actual experiment in our lab.
Yes. So, okay, yeah. Currently these simulation efforts are also going on where they talk about disks falling. So, how? Because if you look at the disks interacting, you need to look at the various contact points on the disks.
Yeah.
Which is a two-dimensional plane. So how is this simulation efforts going on in that direction?
Okay, so you're asking a very nice question. See, one thing which I didn't talk about is when, you know, you have large disks or large bodies where, you know, the body is not a point object. Like here in Maxey-Rayleigh, I pretended that the body is a point object. It has a velocity v. So if I know its velocity v, I'm happy with that. So that, and to know its velocity v, I did all of this. Whereas, like, if I have a big body, like a disk, it could be, you know, oriented differently. I would need to know how it's oriented with respect to gravity. I would need to know how it interacts with other things. And this orientation can change a lot for the flow. So then it could be rotating, spinning. All of those I've pretended doesn't exist because the body is small. So like it could be spinning very rapidly. Then I have to satisfy boundary conditions for the fluid very carefully on each, you know, point on the surface. I should satisfy the flow boundary condition. So this becomes an enormously complicated problem. In this photo, I deliberately showed you the simpler one where the sphere is rigid and it's held fixed and the fluid is going past it. But imagine if the sphere and the fluid are talking to each other, or a disk and a fluid are talking to each other. So the disk is spinning, it's rotating the fluid. Then like the next minute it can happen that the disk so here I'm pretending that the body doesn't have any kinetic energy of its own. It's infinitely dense and it doesn't move. That's the imagination when you hold it rigid. You're saying it's infinitely dense. But wait, like real disks have finite density. So a real disk which is flowing in a fluid can exchange kinetic energy with the fluid. So because of this concept called the added mass, it can go slow and allow the fluid to become very high in motion. It can go fast and you know, reduce the kinetic energy in the fluid. Depending on how it's forced, things can change. So like there's very, very few simulations, and only such simulations are starting, I would say, in the last decade or even less, where people are able to put many bodies in the fluid, big bodies, satisfy everything on the body, satisfy, solve Navier-Stokes equation, understand about how the body is affecting the fluid, how the body is affecting the other body through the fluid, and then like the further complicated question that Dheeraj was asking about when they come in contact. So in fact, like Dheeraj, I would like to refer you to a recent paper I've written with Eric Usman. He was my joint student. He actually got his degree in the University of Edinburgh. His other guide was Prashant Valluri. He used to come to India for like many months at a time, and we did this work together. So there is a JFM paper last year on ellipsoids where we've actually done some theoretical understanding of this problem, just one ellipsoid going through a fluid and how you can get chaotic motion in that situation.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Sure.
Okay, I have one question.
Yes.
Rama Govindarajan.
Sure.
See, you have nicely shown a bigger raindrops coming down, the smaller raindrops then going up, etc. So it's about the cloud physics, some of the insights. Now the from the Feynman lecture days, we know as an example in the clouds, you have the top positive charge region,
negative
charge region, etc. And the formation of thunderstorm. Now, do you think people have more results based on numerical simulation about these thunderstorms and tornadoes?
Okay, like to start from the particle level and go and explain the thunderstorm, I don't think anybody has done. Those are all open questions. Like maybe with artificial intelligence, some of these questions will become tractable because you can learn about, you know, what tiny, tiny charges on a tiny, tiny droplet are doing and then like take it to the bigger level. But no, like these problems are not solved. But even if you take like, you know, let me say that these two raindrops, like this guy is falling fast, this guy is falling slow, this guy is catching up with this guy and they're going to coalesce. I told you one reason why I could be wrong. But the charge can be another completely different aspect. Like imagine both of them are positively charged. Okay, but when they come close to each other, somehow then, like let's say this guy is not charged and this guy is positively charged because it fell from a greater height. So then this guy, the negative charges will come close to this end, right? When they come very close to each other. And then there can be an attractive interaction. And those kinds of things are not at all like accounted for till now. It's not easy to account for every physics that's happening. But yes, like the electrostatics is a very important part of this and charges are a very important part of this. And we know, all we know is that they get charged somehow. And when large amounts of charge is created, you get, you know, discharged by lightning. But that's also an open question. And actually, like my student, Kroor, Ravichandran, whose cloud work I talked about a lot, like he is looking at lightning and things as part of his postdoc. And this is again a big, big class of open questions. I hope that answered what you were asking.
Thank you. But you made a very nice point. Do you think artificial intelligence means through machine learning?
Exactly.
This problem?
Exactly. Like machine learning tools are very much needed for these problems to make them tractable, because otherwise, like, we'll be waiting for some massive quantum computer where I can solve everything exactly. I don't know when that's happening, but machine learning is one way to go.
Nice.
And I would definitely be very happy if people with machine learning expertise wanted to collaborate on different aspects of this with me, where we could scale it up and go to bigger questions.
Okay, that is a very nice, thank you, Professor Rama Govindarajan, because many of our BTech engineering students, after taking their machine learning and artificial intelligence courses, yes, to do projects where they can utilize their expertise on a range of topics. Maybe certainly I will give your name and email address to them. Some of them might contact you. Thank you.
Sure.
Can you ask any other question?
I normally work with people who come and stay with me for 1 year minimum. But if there's a faculty member in Dharwad who can take care of some part of the collaboration, that can work.
Okay. I wonder whether anybody else has any questions now. If no question, does anybody have any questions? Please put in the chat box or raise your hands. If not, thank you so much, Professor Rama Govindarajan, for a very exciting talk. Back to Sushma.
Thank you so much.
Last few hours were truly very engaging, ma'am. So it's time to express gratitude to all those who made this wonderful event possible. Foremost, I thank Professor Rama Govindarajan for sparing her valuable time and for her insightful talk on dynamics of small particles in flow. I thank Professor Vandana Nanal for sharing her valuable experiences with us with regards to IPA. heartfelt thanks to Professor Narasimha, whose enthusiasm is boundless and his constant efforts have made this event successful. I thank the administration of IIT Dharwad for supporting the conduction of this event. And lastly, I thank the wonderful audience for your presence and eagerness to learn, which motivates us all. With this, let's conclude the event. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you again.